You're listening to the AfterBuzz TV Network, now the largest new media platform on the web, and your number one source for after-show entertainment. Very good, Keith Johnson. The AfterBuzz Studios in Los Angeles, California. Presented by Maria Menounos and Bing.com. And streaming live thanks to Akamai Technologies. This is AfterBuzz TV's Downton Abbey After Show. We'll break down tonight's episode and get you all the latest news and gossip. And now, another post-game wrap-up show for your favorite TV show. It's AfterBuzz TV's Downton Abbey After Show.
Oh, welcome everybody. Bing is doing, and Tamara's already in tears. Yes, Bing is doing, and we are doing another AfterBuzz TV show, after show for Downton Abbey, the season 3 finale. I'm your host, John Comerford, and I'm joined in the studio by the very teary-eyed Tamara Berg.
Hey, everybody.
And of course, Alina Akram.
Hi, everyone.
And our very special guest host, you know her better, well, she's a huge fan of Downton Abbey, first of all, we need to say that first, but you know her better as the voice season 2 star and recording artist, Katrina Parker.
Katrina.
Thanks for having me.
I said,
you got a little tongue twisted.
Beg your pardon if I didn't say
you're
that
excited.
Correctly. Katrina. Okay, there's so much to cover. We have obviously 2 hours, and they did not hold anything back.
There was no resting during
this. No, they
this
just
episode.
Put it all in there, and they said, let's get it all in 2 hours and see what comes of it. But we went from Downton to Duneagle. We've had a lot of very odd pairings in this particular episode.
We did.
And of course, we saw the demise of Matthew. So, and how are we feeling about this, ladies?
So sad.
This was the spoiler that I accidentally read about around a month ago.
Yeah.
I was doing research for the show, and in the UK newspapers, there's this giant headline, Julian Fellows talks about why he killed off Matthew. And I'm like, curses! I mean, we had talked about how that it was a possibility because there had been rumblings about Dan Stevens leaving the show.
Yeah.
And when I was...
Yeah, and we do our best not to even be aware of anything so that it comes to us as it comes to the show. So.
Right.
And Katrina, you may have been a little bit aware of the possibility.
I was. I mean, I read the news that he was leaving the show, I think it was a few weeks ago,
right.
A couple months, and I was like, oh, great. Well, we know what's... I mean, I knew it was coming.
Yeah. Yes.
I knew it was coming, and that kind of ruined it for me a little, but it was still a little graphic enough and dramatic enough that it still... I mean, it still made me cry.
And what about you? Alina, you had no idea, right?
I didn't expect it. I had read also that he wanted to leave. However, I never read that it had actually happened or it was a final decision.
So it came as a shocker to you, right?
I still don't believe it.
You still think he might be alive, right? You still think he
Listen,
may be
Listen, those truck drivers are going to run around.
There was a lot of blood coming out of his ear.
There was a lot of blood.
I don't know what you're talking about, okay?
Yeah. So
I refuse to believe it.
She's going to hang on to her hope. No matter what. So.
It was, well, and the thing is that, you know, as I watched this episode, I didn't know how it was going to happen, but since I had read the spoiler, I knew it was going to happen. And I thought it was really interesting because through the entire episode, they kept doing those hunting scenes, right? We go to Duneagle and there are guns and swords all over all the walls. And so I kept watching that with this knowledge that Matthew was probably not going to make it and thought, oh, there's going to be a grisly hunting accident. And, you know, every single one of those shots inside the house and then the shots during... I was tense through the whole thing. And then he ends, you know, his end comes in one of the most joyous moments of his life.
Right.
Well, he's happy. It's just all of us who are left without him who are sad.
That's true. Yes. But I thought it was interesting that they chose to do it that way because it's a, quote, modern contraption that killed him and he, you know, represents that and the whole thing, how they've been playing that through the whole series.
That's a dark place to go to.
Well,
I like
you know,
it.
I mean, well, you know, and even the way he was driving, he's kind of like, you know, almost, you know, swerving down the road with glee.
Yeah.
So, and then not to be. And as it's happening, I'm going, oh, man, they're going to kill him with a car. He's going to get another traffic accident. How hard did that, I mean, in the English countryside, to get in a traffic accident?
Just
so
there's no cars on the road.
So, and a lorry comes by. So, yeah. But, all right, but prior to that happening, of course, they do their duty, and they have set an heir for Downton, so that's safe, of course. So, and who was, I think everybody was saying that the babies are harbingers of doom. Every time a baby comes, somebody dies.
No, I think babies.
It's a one in, one out philosophy.
Right,
the
exactly.
New baby comes, we gotta get running.
Yes, so, you're gonna lose an adult.
That's
every
right.
Time.
So, yeah, anybody in the cast, we're having another baby. Everybody in the cast goes, oh no.
And it's not even Edith going, it's people no. that everyone really cares about.
So,
poor Edith.
I'm just kidding.
Poor Edith.
Right.
Sacrifice the poor middle child. So, why do you feel about that,
but,
Tamara?
Okay.
No. Yeah. Poor Edith.
Did anybody think for a second, because they were, you know, obviously they did such a pointed way of talking about Mary saying, I shouldn't be going on this, don't dance. All kept trying to talk about how challenging her pregnancy was and she shouldn't be overexerting herself. Did anybody think for a second that baby, you did, Alina, you
the
thought
whole
that,
time I was like, why is Mary going? She's had difficulty getting pregnant in the beginning, and yeah. we saw what happened to Sybil.
Yeah.
I'm like, are they going to repeat this, you know, the whole Sybil story with Mary, or at least the complication with the baby? So yeah. I was worried.
You were nervous about it the whole time.
Little
yeah.
did I know.
Yeah. They did their job then. Good. They distracted you.
Right. You know, the other things that I thought were really well laid out yeah. through the toward the end of this episode was all the reverence to Matthew and what he had done, and yes. everyone basically declaring their great love for him. You know, Mary saying, mm-hmm. I feel I am half of myself, I'm only half of myself without him. Lord Grantham yeah. thanking him profusely, and we'll mm-hmm. get into more of that.
Yeah.
But, you know, just, you know, sending him off yeah. in a very fine
yeah,
way.
Exactly.
A hero's
also, I think they were also
departure.
Setting up, they were setting up Mary, because she kept saying, you know, he kept saying, you're going to be a wonderful mother, you're a terrific yeah. person, all these things, and she's going, I know you think that, but I hope I'm the Mary of your Mary, not Edith's Mary or anybody else's Mary. And yes, I was saying that too. It's like, you know, because if she's Edith's Mary, she's not a very nice person.
No, I mean,
right. And Matthew was her greatest champion.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Aside from Lord Grantham.
Right. And
yeah.
you know, it and she kept saying, I know you think that. I go, yeah, a lot of people don't think that. They're not high on Mary at the moment.
Right.
Such a snob about Gregson and everything, the whole thing with Edith and.
She's the mean girl in high school.
Yeah.
Can we talk? It's not really a prediction. So can we just talk about what we think, how we think that's going to affect Mary in the next season?
Sure.
Boy.
Well, I think that's why they were doing it. They were trying to set her up to say, look, the only one on her side is Matthew, and now he's gone. So now, what's she going to do?
Poor Edith. That's all I got to
say.
Oh,
no.
Mary is going to be a bee with a vengeance.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And
she's going to bury her?
Everybody.
Yeah.
Stay out of her way.
Because she's going to be so angry about losing Matthew.
And I think she's not even going to care about that child. At least not initially.
Wow, that's a huge
postpartum
prediction.
Depression.
Okay.
I mean,
Katrina,
yeah.
what do you think? What do you think about how Mary's going to be next season?
I mean, two things could happen. I feel like they could either take her to a very dark place where she gets very angry and that kind of mean. I feel like she's very complex. She has a very mean streak in her.
Yeah.
Yes.
And I think she also has a very good heart that Matthew brought out. So without him to kind of rein her in, is she going to become Edith's Mary, or is that baby going to be the thing that kind of helps her soften up and
right.
become a kinder human being? Or is the baby going to, again,
yeah.
remind postpartum
her.
Depression, and you know what I mean? Is that
well,
going to happen?
If you think of where they ended last series, you know, they ended it with the proposal in the snow
yeah.
and all that, and how everybody
so
was so
gorgeous and so romantic.
And everybody's happy, and this series ends with a death, and oh my God, they're split apart. And as always, all TV shows go, it's better when the two will they, won't they, rather than when they are. So she's going to have more fun that way because they'll bring somebody else in, right?
Right, yeah. We do have news and gossip about some of that, so we can talk about that. Yeah, we've got a little news and gossip. But, you know, another thing that I wanted to mention, because you talk about how they call them series in
right.
each season, a series in the UK, and we call them series. Or seasons.
We call them seasons. They call them
and,
series.
And so this episode is called the Christmas special because it aired on Christmas Day mm-hmm. in the UK. And I saw an interview with Julian Fellowes talking about how last season, you know, Christmas Day, everyone's fat and happy, open presents, have their, you know, glug in hand. Do they drink glug in the UK?
Oh.
And, you know, sit down to watch Downton Abbey a year ago, and I get the proposal. And this year, he said, I was very cognizant of the fact that people were going to be sitting down after Christmas dinner and watching Matthew die. And he said it was gut-wrenching
yeah.
to make that choice, but he had to make that choice because it wasn't like, you know, Matthew could go off to India and, you know, yeah. and be okay. He had to, his character had to die. And so it was a difficult decision for him to make.
I saw the look on Alina's face.
Did he have to do it on, like, couldn't he do it next season? I don't know.
Yeah. Well. No. Apparently not.
Dan,
sorry.
Dan Stevens. I'm just saying, he better become an Oscar-winning actor.
Yeah, a lot of people are ticked off. Why couldn't you keep doing the series and do movies?
Yeah, well, and people are saying it's a Caruso, you know?
Yeah.
David Caruso move, so. We do have news about him as well. So let's move on to the next one.
All right, but so let's move on from that. The whole reason everything sets into place is because they decided to go from Downton to Duneagle, and it's... I thought was so fascinating is the way that Bates set up the whole thing, that this is the highlight of his lordship's calendar.
Yes.
And they usually go there. And then you find out why, and Grantham just loves this place because it harkens to a day that he still wants to live. It's the tradition. He even likes the bagpipes. He's glad to hear that they're keeping up with the old ways. And to him, this is paradise. This is what it should be. And of course, as he's there, he starts to learn more and more. This ain't no paradise.
Right,
paradise,
the layers
lost.
Get peeled away,
right.
And he sees so, down to.
But it's set up wonderfully. I mean, and the whole series open. Well, the whole a particular episode, I should say, the opening credits was totally different, which was like, whoa, what's going on here?
Yeah, I wonder if that's just for the special or if it's for the whole next season.
We don't know.
Because I've developed a particular fondness for the dog's butt.
I was gonna say the dog's butt.
Yeah.
We have ESP.
Yeah, Katrina likes the butt. There you go.
I did love the.
You heard it here.
Where they were packing everything up and getting ready to go on the train. I thought it was really pretty.
I think they just...
And the chaos of...
I honestly think they should screw the credits. We need to throw more stuff. We don't have the time for the credits.
I know.
We need this stuff over the credits. But,
true.
And then when you come up to Duneagle, that shot, what a castle that is.
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah.
I learned a little bit about it. It is in Scotland.
So dark.
Yeah.
And it's a place called Inverera Castle. Owned by the Campbell family, and it was built not as a fortress,
right.
Not as anything, but for the glory of our wealth and position.
But to impress, yeah. It was built to impress
exactly.
Fortress, yeah.
And they were talking about how the Scottish castles fancy manors are very different from English ones. And I think it was Julian Fellows was talking about how different they are, and that they're you're definitely in Scotland, which is a little more salt of the earth, I think.
Right.
So that's it. That's all I wanted to say about Inverera.
But it looked great.
It's beautiful. I mean, at one point it looked like a miniature.
Yeah, no.
I was like,
yes.
Is this fake? Is this because they did like a faraway shot? It looks like a perfect miniature lawn and everything.
Yeah.
So I'm glad it's a real.
It's a real place.
Thank
it's a real
you.
Place.
I just saw Doom when they walked in, and I saw all those, the swords,
yeah.
The guns.
I thought that was the foreshadowing.
Yeah, I was like, geez, this is not exactly Downton.
No.
Where are the flowers?
Yeah, exactly.
Where's the warmth? Yeah.
The tapestries and the flowers. Where's
the
silver?
Let's talk about that. It isn't Downton, so even though Grantham wants it to be, he wants it to be the thing, the end-all, be-all of everything. The bagpipes I thought was hysterical, because the next time he hears those bagpipes, he's not so happy about them.
No,
the pillow over his head.
And, of course, as soon as he gets there, we know that Shrimpy and Lady Fletcher, they're at odds. And of course,
Shrimpy and Susan.
That's right. Rose, giddy to see the Grantham, the Crowley girls. She's happy to see them. But we know that this, whatever it is, we don't know what it is, but we know Shrimpy and Susan are not too happy with it.
Susan is just, she's a bitter,
she's
bitter
a
woman.
Pill.
She's unpleasant.
Yes.
She's a pill. That's a great description of her.
She's a pill.
Sour.
A shrill pill, too.
Very shrill.
Sour. She's
terrible.
Got a lemon in her mouth all the time.
And so, but let's get into a little bit, because, Grantham just is so happy to be there. And then every step of the way, Shrimpy just tells him, well, it's really not that great. We're getting transferred. It's going to be a horrible place, but I don't care because we don't really like each other anyway.
Right?
It's like, what?
So depressing.
I felt bad for Grantham. He just wants, I haven't been able to be here for years. I just want to come back and have a good time, and everything gets taken away from him because it's just a horrible place now with and no
fighting
fun.
And tension. And
yeah.
So much
so
tension.
So awkward.
I mean, that's like the awkward family dinner you don't want to go to. Susan and Shrimpy, everything's like a battlefield. You don't know where the mines are, like where to step.
In fact, he stepped right in, remember, as he's coming down the stairways and they're fighting, yeah. And he goes, I know my way home.
I know, I know where I'm going.
Find my way.
I was
not staying
watching
here.
It. Yeah. I can't imagine.
Yeah. And didn't you just want somebody to yell at Susan?
Yes.
Would you, somebody put her. Yeah. It's terrible. She was
horrible.
She's
just incredibly critical of Rose all the time. And you know, Rose called her out. Can't I go just 5 minutes without being criticized by you? I know some of us feel that way about our moms sometimes, but it was just relentless, it looked like, for Rose.
Alina. Well, it helped me understand Rose a lot better, too. Her rebellious streak. It's like, oh.
I see.
This makes sense.
Yeah. Yes. Agreed.
I think for me, when Shrimpy says that if I had any gumption, I would have modernized like you and we would have saved.
That was
Duneagle.
Fantastic.
So Duneagle is going to be gone.
Yes. Yeah.
So Grantham again realizes Downton's the only place. What's left of it anyway. Mm-hmm.
Right.
So that's when he finally realizes this is no paradise and I should be happy with what I have. And, you know. And that's when he really, as you were speaking earlier, that's when he really appreciates Matthew for all he's doing to save it. So,
yes, I give thanks
for
Matthew.
A full circle in those 2 hours for him.
I know, right?
Yeah, and he can't wait to get back now. And not just because of the baby. So, anyway, I thought that was wonderful. So, let's see. Before we go any further, we want to take a moment to thank everybody for writing in and giving us comments. Tamara will look into those and see if we have any thanks personally. But please do go to iTunes, rate and comment, download for us, and keep that going. What do we got? We got names?
Yeah, Arlene and AZ, we want to thank you for your comment. Also, Gus in Tampa, Matter Gray, and Dusty Lyric. Also, one of these ones, Dusty Lyric said, so glad that AfterBuzz picked up Downton Abbey. Any chance of doing a season one and season two summary or character study episodes after the Christmas special in order to pass the long time until season four?
Wow.
And we were kind of talking about that last week. So we're not sure really what we can do that will...
We'll look into that.
We'll look into it. Watch my and Alina's Twitter Twitter pages for that, and also AfterBuzz on Facebook.
That's right.
And on Twitter, I want to thank Tom Branson's girl. He was giving us really nice compliments.
Yes, very nice.
Or girl, she was.
She.
All right, we'll have more on the end news, and also just to remind everybody, during our special segment, we'll talk to Katrina about what she's doing lately, and
great.
Get all the information on that. But before we get to that, let's go on to our next topic. Well, because while the cat's away, the servants will play.
Yes.
And at Downton, all they're looking for is a breather. All they want to do is sit down and relax.
They just want to sit on upholstered furniture.
And have Mrs. Hughes catch them. And Carson goes, wants to have none of it. He goes, what, we're not paying
Are
you
Are we
now?
Not paying you?
Or they not paying you, I guess is how he said it.
Are you not being paid?
Yeah, I just love that, you know, Hughes and Carson were great in this because they're just having she's going to bat for the servants. Oh, let them have it. And it was like completely like a mother-father thing. Oh, come on, let the kids have some fun.
It's so true.
No, they get to their chores. That's all it seemed like to me. It was a lot of fun to see them play that role.
It was fun. They're so good together.
They are. But Carson, of course, he showed he had a little tender spot because he said, you know, yes, they're going to go, but I won't.
What, don't you think it'll be fun, Mrs. Hughes said?
Yeah, because if I go, no one's going to have any fun. They're always going to
be looking over their shoulders.
That was fun.
That was nice.
It was, and it's
kinda
true.
Had that glint in his eye.
Yeah.
I loved that moment where he looked at Mrs. Hughes and she was like, you were right.
At the table, exactly.
Yeah, it was great.
Again, very husband and wife, mom and dad.
But then if you didn't feel good enough about Carson, then he has that moment of a little baby sip.
Oh, my ovaries exploded. I'm not going to lie. That was beautiful.
It was so sweet.
It was.
All of you at the same time, the reactions of you.
Let's have a chat about it, he says. You can so see people.
And she's so darn cute.
She's really cute.
Little baby Sybil.
Mm-hmm. Gorgeous. Oh, so that moment was really...
That really did it for
me.
Yeah, I mean, it would have been interesting to see the poll on that. Every woman watching that go,
aww. It was literally hilarious.
Well, it's like watching your dad, like, you know what I mean, pick up a baby, like, you know, I don't know. It's just the relationship he had with Sybil was so special. So that moment, I mean, we haven't got to see that yet so far, and to see that was really lovely.
But, of course, all along, you know, I was thinking he's going to let him go, but he has to, you know, complain about it. He has to,
of course,
bitch and moan about it.
He wouldn't be him.
Exactly.
He wouldn't be him if he didn't.
Must I be undermined at every turn? Like, he's so put upon.
I love it.
It's terrible. Marissa, you have something to say about the swags, don't you?
We had just launched this new thing here at AfterBuzz TV, the AfterBuzz TV store. So if you go to AfterBuzzTV.com, click on the little icon banner up at the top left, It'll direct you straight to the AfterBuzz TV store. You can buy mugs, bags, shirts for women and for men, baby onesies.
For little baby Sybil.
Little baby Sybil,
right.
So get your AfterBuzz swag.
Get your AfterBuzz swag.
There you go.
All right, so we've talked about the odd pairings, and for me, this isn't such an odd pairing, but a new pairing because Edna appears.
Edna, Michelle Pfeiffer lookalike, wasn't she, kind of?
Oh.
Okay, yeah.
I see that.
Right?
I get it. That's because something was
Yeah, there was something familiar about her, and that's what I was saying was, yeah, she's so beautiful.
She's really beautiful.
And clearly doesn't know her place.
No.
No.
Awkward.
Talk about sassy.
Right. I said sassy. Cheeky. Cheeky was the word
very.
I used. Yeah.
I had very negative feelings towards her because I'm, you know, Sybil.
Yeah,
me too.
I feel like protective of Branson for some reason.
Even though it's been a year?
Even though it's been a year. Because
it's only been a week for us.
It's only been a week, and it seems like she was just here, you know, very recently, and seeing someone kind of, I don't know, like, I mean, it was exciting for him, but it also, I felt like, was uncomfortable for him, and it made him really question what he was doing, and I hate that.
Well, I thought it was a really complicated scenario, because he's now of the family, but he was downstairs before. She's downstairs, but feels like she doesn't she's a very modern woman, doesn't have the barriers of caste or, you know, class
propriety.
System like they do there. And so it was a really complicated thing for them both to, well, not her, because she knew what she wanted, but it was a little complicated for Tom, right? And,
yeah,
and trying to figure out where he was. And
it was a tough one.
And also Mrs. Hughes saying in the end, you know, she made you question where you've come from, where you have come.
And who you are.
And who you are, and that's not right.
Right.
She was a bit manipulative, and I feel like she was playing against, you know, the fact that he's now a part of their family and, you know, trying to make him feel bad for that. It's not
fair. Did you get the feeling did you get the feeling that, you know, she's obviously fancied him. She thinks he's good looking. I'll give him that or whatever.
Yes.
You think she was just social climbing? Well, if he can do it, I can do it.
I hope not. I mean, I just got that she found him very attractive and was, like, playing with fire a little bit. And, I mean, he's obviously still vulnerable. I think she could sense that. And I don't know. I had a really negative feeling from the first time she was on screen with him.
Exactly.
I just was this
was
not good for
Every step of the way, she's crossing lines. And, well, first of all, she picks up Sybil's.
I
mean,
I was just going to say that.
Picture. I was like, whoa, what are you doing?
Hey, don't touch that.
Yeah, it's like, and then Mrs. Hughes comes in. But before Mrs. Hughes is even there, I'm going, hey, put that down.
That's Sybil. I was thinking the same thing. You stole the words from my mouth. Like, and she even moved it.
Yeah,
she didn't put it towards his bed anymore.
Too soon.
Oh, no, you don't.
That's right. Alina, not happy with Edna.
No.
Yeah.
Thank you.
You know, Sybil will always have a place in his heart.
So speaking to that, when he finally broke down, because Mrs. Hughes was saying, look, don't, I mean, then he finally gives it up. It's like, I can't bear to be without her. How long is he hanging on to that? He hasn't been able to say that to anybody, really.
No. I mean, how are you going to have an honest conversation with these people that took so long to accept you and really fought it every step of the way? I mean, that moment was beautiful, and it made me cry a little, you know, because we haven't heard him really be able to articulate that.
Right, and what do we think about Tom now? Because in the beginning, you know, when they started him, he was just, you know, kind of just an angry, you know, person who just wanted to get in your face about whatever you do and the discrepancies in society and all that other stuff. And now he's just this fleshed out human being. And how are you feeling about him now?
He's very likable now and sweet and a good father, or what seems like a good father.
Yeah.
I don't know. And I feel like he still has his values.
Yeah.
But out of respect for Sybil and her family, he's trying to adjust.
It's interesting, though, that he always has doubts, because if he didn't have doubts, Edna wouldn't have had any traction on her argument that you should
That's
come down
right.
with that,
yeah.
so you're embarrassed about who you are or who you were. So obviously he's having all those kinds of thoughts in his head. But it was kind of like the two angel and devil on your shoulder. You got Edna and then Mrs. But even Isabel got into it. She's the one that said, look, you have nothing to be ashamed about. You managed the transition really well. And now that you have a position, you're entitled to use it. So you can speak to anybody. So, and she's trying, and I think of anybody, Isabel is always the one that's right on point trying to help people and do the right thing.
Yeah.
And here she was just trying to help him too. So, I mean, you got to give her credit. Isabel always comes through for
that.
She
really does. She really does. She's very, she's a sympathetic ear to anyone who will listen and is definitely a champion for anyone and what they want.
Except the Dowager. She may not be such much
No, maybe not. But she's so, for the most part, kind to her.
Oh yeah,
you know.
always. But okay. Now speaking of kind, since we're just on Isabel, unless there's more you want to talk about Tom and Edna.
Oh gosh, no.
Because I wanted to get into Isabel and Dr. Clarkson.
Oh man.
It was.
I'm so embarrassed for him.
Yes.
She's just oblivious, or she's completely uninterested.
Well, right. What do you think? What's your take on that, Katrina?
I mean, I want her to be oblivious, but she kind of seems like she's too smart for that.
Mm-hmm.
I wonder. I don't know if it's out of fear, or she just likes the status quo and she likes where she is right now in her life and she just doesn't want to be in a relationship. But I mean, I think they would be so sweet together. I don't know.
I thought so too.
I'm a romantic. I thought so too.
Alina?
I like the pairing, but I feel like she just likes her status, like you mentioned. Mm-hmm. She likes where she is in her life, and she probably feels like if I get married, I'll be tied down. I won't have the independence I do now.
Mm-hmm. She definitely is, for a woman of her age, she definitely represents the independent woman.
Oh, sure.
Sort of. You know, because she doesn't have a husband, and probably also partly because Matthew is in a position of power.
Right. I'm sure that elevated her status.
And it just sort of lets her relax a little bit and be more modern.
Right.
I think, don't you?
Yeah. So, but, it, you know, as it's happening, I'm going, oh, my God, no, this is uncomfortable. Oh, no, as you're seeing it happen, and he downs his, courage.
Irish courage. So, yeah, exactly. Is it Dutch courage? Richmond, I don't know.
Hey,
liquid courage.
There
let's
you
just
go.
Put it that
careful.
Way.
Careful.
Sorry. Sorry, all the Irish
courage.
And the Dutch.
Yeah, but, you know, she did a great job because as it's happening, I honestly was going, did she see it happening? I couldn't quite tell.
I couldn't
tell. The whole time
really
when she says,
tell.
I have no idea what you're talking about. So, you know, I really was wondering, but she's so smart, she had to have known. But she didn't really tip her hat very well.
At the end, that's the moment when I was like, oh, she's not oblivious now.
Yeah.
She gets it, and for whatever reason. But the rest of the time, I was hoping she was oblivious because I feel like she was, I don't know. I mean, she was being very warm with him, but she knew she was leading him on a little, whether she realized it or not.
Right.
Because she was leaving,
him,
you know.
Dinner.
But
dinner.
I thought she gave
not
him.
Supper.
I thought she gave him a great out.
It was
you know?
Yeah, wonderful.
It was actually. It sure could have been more embarrassing.
Yeah, but how about him? I really appreciated him coming back, thanking her for not, so he didn't make a fool of himself.
Yes.
I mean, you could have easily just walked away and said, "Ooh, I dodged a bullet," you know. But no, he wanted to acknowledge her her grace in the matter.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Do you think there's any chance that they could become a pair?
Because of that, I think there is.
Oh, see, I would like that. Wouldn't you like that?
And she's gonna be devastated after Matthew dies.
Oh, she
might need a shoulder.
Whoa! I didn't even think. Can't believe I didn't even think about that. Of course, yeah.
It's her son.
Oh.
Who else is gonna comfort her?
Oh my God!
That'd be great.
Nice, Alina.
Here's my prediction. She's just gonna become a big drinker. She's gonna be a sloppy drunk.
I would like that.
Okay,
that
maybe
would
not.
Be fun. I don't see it happening.
Maybe not. She's a little too proper, but it would be entertaining.
She's always looking for that thing to save or to, you know, foster or whatever. Now she's gonna be the one that's needing.
That's true.
So, this I would imagine Clarkson
that
would
is
be
gonna
that.
Make for some great drama next season. That's a good one, John. I like that. Well, I know we're kind of peppering and Alina.
Yeah.
It's definitely Alina.
And they look great together when they're at the fair.
They have a lot of things in common.
And you know, she was married to a doctor, so it's like,
And he said to her when in his sort of declaration, or one of his declarations, he was saying, you know me and my life better than anyone.
Right. So
I'm ready for it.
I'm slightly heartbroken for him.
Yes.
Now that we're talking
Speaking of heartbreaking, let's move on to Edith.
Oh, great.
poor
Edith.
I have so many Edith jokes.
We have talked about... Yeah, exactly. Well, lay them out, because we've talked about it like crazy. We know that, you know, as soon as any love was professed for Edith, it was going to come with strings attached.
Tragedy.
Yes.
A tragedy down the road,
yes,
for
exactly.
sure.
So, and... How desperate was Mr. Gregson?
Oh, I didn't like it.
He bought tails.
Kind of uncomfortable.
Just happened to be in the neighborhood.
I'm going to be at Duneagle, as a matter of fact, just a few yards down the road.
Call me
on my cell.
You know, putting aside Mary's snobbery about the whole thing, I just figured the guy has...
Mary was bitchy about it.
He really has tails. He has dinner attire. And, you know, you got to give the guy credit because, look, I have to win her over, so I've got to win the family over.
Right?
So at least he's, you know, he's not doing it in any odd
it's
ways.
It's not being underhanded at all. He's exactly. being very upfront about right. it, which yeah. is which is honorable, I think.
That's what I think.
Okay.
You know, it's, but you,
all right, I agree.
It's just that, you know it's not going to happen.
I know. I was surprised that Matthew's the one who nipped it.
I was
well,
too.
He was, so was she.
Well, he was definitely, though, becoming the, he's becoming the, well, not anymore, but, he's becoming the lord of the manor, sort
yeah.
of.
That, yeah, and the defender yeah. of the downtrodden, as Rose called him. I mean, remember, he's the one that saved Rose with that whole thing last
sure.
week at the bar. So it seemed to me, of course, and even said, do you think I would let her live this life of misery without lifting one figure to stop it?
Yeah.
So, Matthew.
He's, and he has to.
We miss you already.
So,
but, we'll talk about it in news, but...
Whoa.
Yeah, well, actually, let me just say this one because it helps us talk about what we're talking about. I don't have these papers here. Hang on. Carmichael, who plays Lady Edith, is set to get feisty next season.
She's very happy about that.
She said that Lady Edith is now becoming quite a modern, independent woman. And to quote Laura, she said she's coming into her own a little bit, I think. It's all been ups and downs. But I think after being jilted, she's thrown it all out the window. Any ideas she did have in place, and I think that's been good for her, it's given her a bit of independence and hotspur. I love playing her. So... I think that says that Lady Edith is going to become a bit of a trollop. She's going to become the family trollop.
No.
I'm okay with this.
Me too.
Maybe sassy. I don't think trollop, but sassy.
No,
maybe.
Actually, trollop is not. She would never.
No.
But I think that's sort of the indicator that I think she's going to have a relationship with Gregson.
Do you think with okay?
I do.
What do you think?
Well, she's probably realizing life is too short.
Right.
Mm-hmm. I've been playing by the rules this whole time, and
if Matthew can die, anybody can die at any minute.
Why not take advantage?
Right. And convention says I shouldn't because he's already married, but just because the law hasn't caught up with this and there's no mechanism for him to divorce a woman who's mentally insane.
Right.
Why should I not have a life that's happy?
And he is he seems like a good man. I mean, he seems genuinely
honorable.
Interested.
Yeah.
So
it was good enough for Jane Eyre.
You
know?
There you go. but would you like to see them together?
I'd like to see them together. I mean, I feel like, unfortunately, the men that she tends to be attracted to are just all impossible for whatever reason.
Right.
It makes me sad. But I'd rather see a happy Edith who's doing something that's, maybe... not with the times,
against convention,
wrong, than to see sad Edith, who's just kind of pathetic, and it's like she kind of like I feel like the last season just wallowed in her misery instead of doing anything about it.
Okay, so then let me ask you this then, because obviously Gregson professes his love to her, and she says I cannot see a happy ending.
Mm-hmm.
And then Matthew says, look, use the gilly ball to say a proper goodbye.
Mm-hmm.
He does that. And she says, this is not goodbye.
Yeah.
And isn't that the exact same thing she did with Sir Charles last year?
Sir Anthony.
Thank you. Excuse me. Sir Anthony. Mm-hmm. It's exactly the same language. It's like, because he said, the same thing. And she said, this is not goodbye. It's the exact same thing. Is she different now? Or is it the same thing?
Well, he's more interested. Mr. Gregson is more interested than
Sir
Anthony.
Sure, he's pursuing her.
So that could be the difference.
That is a definite difference in the situation. Mm-hmm.
He creeps me out less. How's that?
Is it because he's younger?
I don't even think that's it. I don't know. There was something about, I felt like, the previous suitor was just so uncomfortable.
He was awkward.
With whatever feelings he had for her, and it felt really one-sided, whereas I feel like Gregson's very passionate towards her,
right.
In his own way, and I prefer that.
Well, I think it's because Sir Anthony knew it was improper for him to pursue her, and I think that was always in the way of his genuine affection for her. But so
well,
anyway.
And he had the moral conflict of that, she would end up being his nurse.
Yeah, I mean that's insane.
And he didn't want to put her through that.
Yeah.
So in that sense.
And Gregson has his own well,
social dilemma.
Exactly. Maybe not his age, so to speak, but maybe his marital status. It might be a problem. Yeah. Too bad he just can't go on Facebook and change it.
Her taste in men.
Really? Yeah.
So, all right. So we want her to be happy, Edith, but we don't know if that's ever going to be the case. It doesn't look like it, though.
Well, we might have an apocalypse. If Edith's happy for, like, more than, like, one episode, I think something terribly wrong is going to happen for everyone else. It's that the world's turning upside down.
Okay, then think about this. With Mary losing Matthew, and with Edith maybe being happy, what's that going to do to Mary?
Like I said.
She can't stand that.
Poor Edith.
Yeah. Don't want to be in that.
Yeah. I'm with you, Alina.
Yeah, you don't want to be
I don't think it's going to be.
All right.
No. I don't think it's going to be puppies and rainbows for Edith. No. I don't think so.
No. But she's stronger now, so she could take it.
She could take it, exactly.
She's been jilted at the altar.
Yeah.
That's a little harassing.
She can handle anything.
Yeah.
She's going to get it anyway. I mean, honestly, Mary's going to be so desperately unhappy that it's going to happen anyway. So.
And we'll love it, right?
I'm going to enjoy it.
You love that it's going to... Because Mary will bounce back. Mary, she's a survivor.
Enjoying Happy Mary and the Sweet Mary with Matthew.
Yeah. Oh,
and the way they were playing it up this episode, like every scene, they were so affectionate towards
her. Yes.
Mean Julian Fellowes. Breaking my heart. I'm going to write a letter to him.
Mean Dan Stevens.
I know, you're right. I'm blaming the wrong man.
Well, mean leads us to O'Brien.
Yes, it does. That was an excellent segue, John.
All right. So what do we think of it? You know, so we get to Duneagle, and we're eating downstairs with the servants, and that was just to see the difference between Duneagle's downstairs and downstairs. I thought that was fun.
Yes.
How you're called by
the person whom you serve.
Yes, I thought that was interesting. And the everybody standing at military attention when the butler gets up. I mean, not that doesn't happen at Downton, but it isn't as rigid.
Right.
No.
So I thought that was strange. But then we have this kindred spirit as she goes with Wilkins and O'Brien. You know,
I think they both went to the same lurking school. Right? They're both always lurking in the background.
Even the way she was talking and how it was this sugar-coated stuff, you were going, oh, God, that does not feel well when she talks.
No. Mm-mm.
It seems so insincere. And then, of course, when that one time when she calls O'Brien to come in because the lady wants to speak to her.
I'm sure she's going to make a fuss.
Oh, my God. Just the claws came out like crazy.
Yes.
The look she gave when she had to hang on to O'Brien's stuff and fix Lady Flincher's hair. Woo!
Yeah, that was harsh.
Yeah.
Because, all sorts of... not alliances, but pride issues were being crossed there and challenged.
Yes, and then they were also talking about how, you know, Wilkins did not want to leave and go off with Lady, but O'Brien said it would be great. So were they trying to hint that O'Brien is leaving going off with Lady Flincher?
That last scene at the Gilly Ball when she goes up to the Lady Flincher. And
she's grateful.
Yeah, and right before that, what did she tell Wilkins?
Wilkins.
She said... I'm grateful because I don't have to worry about being any loyalty to you.
Oh, that was good.
Yeah. What an O'Brien line.
She put O'Brien, like, I was on O'Brien's side, and I am resentful to Wilkins for that. She made me, like, I was rooting for O'Brien to win, and I'm like, what's happening here?
My world has shifted.
It's
Since when am I rooting for O'Brien? This is wrong. Exactly. She's a witch, that Wilkins. She's charmed us.
Well, and of course we had our nice comedic moment with Molesley taking
that was so awesome.
Last week with Molesley and the cricket game, and this week.
I mean, I wonder if the actor comes up, what am I doing? Oh, come on. Is he happy about what he gets to play, or is he going, really? I got to be the buffoon again? Can I be the good guy?
I think he loves it.
I would. I think
he'd
be great.
He seems to enjoy
it. That's true. He does such a good job at it.
He is so good. That was awesome.
Well, and I think it's funny that, you know, in these modern days of roofies and things like that, that it just took a little whiskey to make everything go all crazy at Gilly Ball.
Yeah, well, you know, it looked like he downed one or two, though, by the end.
He's probably a lightweight too. I mean,
I would imagine.
Yeah, and they don't have a lot of time to drink when they're serving the family. There's not a lot of beer toting time.
No.
Let's go have a pint.
So we don't look forward to whatever O'Brien's gonna bestow upon somebody, because I'm sure that's gonna be horrible.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, we
I kind of look forward to it.
You like that? Huh?
Yes.
You like her lurking about?
I liked it. Okay. When it's not between her and Thomas, I really enjoy it because that made me uncomfortable and it made me really dislike her intensely. Okay. But this, it was like,
this was fair game,
just
because,
as nasty or nastier, right. And so I rooted for her.
Fair game. Know?
I thought it was interesting that they brought somebody in just to go up against O'Brien so that we would like her again.
Ooh, very smart.
Yes.
So just have somebody mean and nastier than O'Brien so we can go, yeah, way to go, O'Brien.
Yeah.
That's true.
Yeah, just turning the tables on us. Julian twisting us like crazy.
Julian. So.
And to think that Wilkins thought that she would fall for her little trick.
Mm.
Yeah. You're not messing with O'Brien. She's a trickster. She doesn't get tricked.
10 steps ahead.
All right. We just talked about this last, but let's do it now. James and Thomas, because we were talking about Thomas and how O'Brien had been going after him. So go ahead, Tamara.
The opening of the show where they're packing up and we see that there's still a little bit of uneasiness in that situation. But
doesn't
obviously
want to be helped.
Right, but they're obviously still working together, and you know, things are status quo to a certain degree.
Yeah, but even when they're going to go out, they talk about going to the fair, and Thomas says, "Yeah, you want to go, James?" And he goes, "Well, I'll go if there's a crowd going, but I'm not going with you."
Right. Yeah.
Basically, what he's saying.
Right.
Yeah.
So you know, and even Albert, Alfred.
Yeah.
Yeah, you know, kind of derides him for, like, you know, get off his case, basically.
Yeah, when they're
right before
down.
They sit down in the lounge chairs. So I thought, you know, trying to, you know, smooth the waters. Let's move
right.
on from this.
Right.
But James wants to have nothing to do with it.
Right.
No.
Well, James came out in this. Didn't come out. That's not the right word. was portrayed in this episode as being, you know, kind of willful and sort of bucking the system with his informed bet.
At
the tug of war. Mm-hmm. And just asserting his will a lot and kind of being a little bit of an upstart.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
More so than he has been in the past. I mean, we haven't really seen it manifest. He was kind of an independent, but sort of coming to the fore more in this episode because of the bet and having his money and getting his drink on and, you know, and then getting in trouble.
Yeah, as soon as he's drinking, I'm going, okay, he's in trouble.
Oh, yeah, well,
he's in trouble.
No, he was very, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
No, go.
He was very, I felt like, unlikable the last few episodes. Like, from the beginning, I didn't love his character. I didn't think he seemed like a kind person.
Right.
And then the way he handled the Thomas thing I thought was really ugly.
Mm-hmm.
And so seeing him this episode just be a little more human and a little more likable, I mean, I think it's about time. Again, they made O'Brien likable and they made him likable. I mean, I'm so confused by this episode. They've really done a good job on me.
They are trifling with our emotions.
They are.
But how about Thomas stepping in, so taking the beating, and James? But I thought it was weird that James just takes off and going, What are you doing?
Know. Well, Thomas did
Why'd
say
get
run.
The doctor?
I know,
run.
But.
Yeah, but.
He should have done it, though.
Yeah.
That was a bit cowardly.
It was, which actually I thought worked because that made him feel even more guilty, which made him go into that room and talk to. I think that's why he went in and talked to Thomas, is that I couldn't even stick around.
Yeah.
So they even talk about that.
And he calls him brave at the end.
It's certainly braver than he was.
Indeed.
So
absolutely, and I think that was a lot of the point.
Yeah.
That was a great scene.
I'm sorry.
No, go ahead, please.
It was a great scene. I don't know. I feel like that was the bravest thing I've seen Thomas do. The most kind of selfless thing. I mean,
absolutely.
He's because he's done some cowardly things in the past.
He really has done some really terrible, horrible things. And this was just a moment where he instinctually, for whatever reason, he took the brunt of the beating and he did something that a lot of braver men maybe wouldn't have done. So, I mean, it was. Everyone just, I feel like, shifted so much this episode. I feel like people that were villains became a little kinder and softer and a little more likable, and he's no exception.
Yeah. And, you know, and it's interesting because it is a year later since last week's episode, so we didn't get to see what's transpired over that year. So obviously they probably had shifts and moves along that arc, but it's good to see that they've come that far in that year.
Yeah.
So, and I thought the scene upstairs with the two of them and they just want to be friends, which, you know, I don't know how that's going to play out because that always works great.
Right. When there's the
unrequited
one-sided
love.
One-sided
exactly.
Love.
But it looked when James actually said, I can do that. I believed him. I thought, okay, he's finally going to make an effort to just...
Yes, it was a really sincere moment.
Yeah, I thought that was a really good moment and a long-awaited one that we've all felt. So, all right, that takes us over to Rose and Lady Fincher. Rose even shifted because now that you know the mom, you know that Rose, you're not so, you don't think she's
not a rebel without a cause anymore. She has a cause.
Yes. Oh, gosh. Susan was bleak. I mean, she's just so unhappy. Yeah. And again, you know, like you said, Rose, you get where Rose is coming from. Last season, I felt like she was, I mean, the episode with her, it was just, she was so just all over the place and so willful and selfish and just she was such trouble for everyone. Mm-hmm. And seeing the environment she was in, I mean, Susan, in the beginning I didn't know where they were going to go with this. I just assumed the man would be, I don't know why I assumed that Shrimpy would be the problem, but then seeing Susan and Shrimpy and the fact that the tension really seemed to originate from Susan with everyone in all her relationships, it was really interesting. I mean, I feel for Rose now. Like, I really like her.
And you really wanted her to end up with Cora, didn't you?
Yes, because then you see her change when she's with Cora. She's the vulnerable, sweet girl that's who she is.
In that situation, she can have a proper mother-daughter relationship.
And it's a bit synchronous because Sybil not being there,
exactly.
Cora taking that place. And so.
That's what Shrimpy asks for. Yeah. He says, I just want you to show her love.
Yeah. And I thought it was great, that line that he said, that, you know, you need to learn, it's like riding horse or riding French if you don't learn it when you're young, and it's hard to get the trick of it later, which is so true.
Susan didn't learn it.
Yeah, but the other things I thought were fascinating in that particular storyline is, you know, obviously from Rose's perspective, she couldn't see how much her mother did care about her, because her mother really was just scared for her. She was just afraid that, you know, horrible things are going to happen to her daughter. She was just trying to do everything she could to protect her. Not doing it very well or in the right way, but that's, for me, that's what her intent was. Yeah. And Cora completely understood that. And, you know, once I got that somebody else understood that, I was like, okay, there's some hope there. Because until Susan realized that somebody else understood her, she was just going to hang on to Rose for as long as she could.
Yeah. I think that's a great observation. That she was sort of doing the wrong things for the right reasons, just in a really dysfunctional way, and in a way that was clearly not effective. But she didn't have another modus.
Right, I think Julian wanted to show us that Susan picked the right person to do this, because the one thing that Susan asks is, "Please speak well of me," not all the time, but and Cora had been speaking well of her to Rose the whole time.
Yes.
Yeah.
And
yes.
I thought, wow, that was... And who would know better than Cora what the mom needed in that instance?
Yeah.
So I thought that was wonderful.
That was a touching moment.
It was wonderful.
A little off topic, but that Susan called Rose a slut.
Yeah. Well, she looks
like it. That was very shocking. Is that the first time? I think that's the first time we've ever heard on the show.
And what did the dowager say? Just like that? Do you remember the line? It was.
I don't remember the line, but it was something very cheeky.
You don't often hear that word amongst the heathers.
That was good. Leave it to her.
That's the dowager, yes, of course. Yeah. And
slut.
And really, all that Susan wanted was somebody to be in her corner. She even asked that, "You're my aunt. Please stick up for me. I get no support here. You know, he's too easy on her, and I'm trying to save her."
Yeah.
At least in her head, anyway.
Right. She had a slight persecution complex.
Yeah.
Because in the beginning, I thought maybe it was them.
Right.
I don't know why I made that assumption. And then I realized her quiet desperation was of her own doing. I mean, like, it became very clear. So she had a little bit of persecution complex going on there.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I can't even imagine living there, being a young woman, living there. What is around? What is there for you to do? And the only person that is, you're having a conversation with, for the most part, is your mother, who's just got the reins on you like crazy.
Yeah.
Ladies, how's that? What's that like?
Awesome. Oh, that's never happened to me.
Yeah, really?
Can anybody stay out of this.
Okay, well, then let's move on to something more fun. Let's talk about Pat Moore.
Mrs. Patmore. She has a love interest.
She's
finally,
so
you know, she'd been,
cute.
Lobbying Julian for a love interest for Miss Patmore for a while.
Oh,
yep.
Really?
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Oh,
finally acquiesced.
That makes it better.
Yeah. So this is, but I go, well, you kind of got what you wanted. I mean, this, you had a flirtation, not really a love interest, so to speak, but...
Well, he was quite a character, wasn't he?
He was the cheeky devil.
Yes. My favorite line in the whole episode was, "In that blouse, you look like you walked off the pages of Vogue." That's what Mrs. Patmore Suitors told her. And I was like, go, Mrs. Patmore.
Yeah. It was golden, that whole thing. My favorite thing that she said was, "No one's wanted to square me since the Golden Jubilee." Yeah. And I just want to say that all the time. No one wants to square me tonight. You know, I mean, it's so much comedy and so much heartwarming stuff happening.
I think you should start a new t-shirt. I want to be squired.
I want to be squired. It's been too long.
Squire me, baby.
That's it. Squire me.
That's good.
Yeah, so let's do that. So what did we think of him? Did we, in the moment at all, did anybody think, okay, this might be it? Or did everybody think, oh, no, what's going on here?
I didn't necessarily think it would work out, but I didn't see him being such a player coming.
Right.
Who knew?
What the heck?
Look at him.
A Lothario.
What a little hoochies. You want to talk about sluts? There was a few at the fair.
There were some sluts at the fair.
Thank God for Mrs. Hughes.
Yeah.
She was like seeing all sorts of stuff that day. Yeah. It was like constantly.
I know.
She's like, oh no, oh no, oh God.
So true. Oh man. Not you.
And Pat Moore's blind to it all. What?
I think it was Thomas she is a woman, isn't she?
Yeah.
Well, only technically.
That was all the lines. Like, I feel like there was so much comedy in this whole situation.
It was so good.
But not at her expense. I felt like she was, especially at the end,
she
her relief.
Like
loved that.
I know, that was a great twist.
It was a surprise, wasn't it?
It was a surprise, and it made me feel better about it.
Thank God, because I go, oh, please, I do not want her sad. I'm having a hard enough time. I don't need another sad moment here, please. Because, she's a nice old lady. Don't have her be just gutted.
No, she did not deserve it. No.
Yeah, it was a great twist, and I was like, thank God.
She was so relieved. Well, he loves to be in love.
Just wanted her for her food.
Yeah. She must make a killer shepherd's pie.
Yeah.
Aww. She does.
And pâté.
And the pâté.
We understand.
Don't forget the pâté.
Yeah, we kind of love that. Man, what else we got?
Anna learning to do the reel.
Oh, yeah, just because Bates has got some Scottish.
Cute.
So much romance.
So
when Bates is staring at her when she's doing it, and oh my goodness. I don't remember the name of the actor, but he's so good.
Brendan Coyle
is so. He's so good with her. The two of them have such amazing chemistry. Mm-hmm. And him watching her dance, I literally kind of got like goosebumps. I'm like, oh my, Brendan Coyle. Hello. Mm-hmm. Hello there.
So basically, we're going to amend this. She wants Brendan Coyle to
squire her.
Yes. Mm-hmm. I will admit it.
I also really like the moment about when Rose was teaching her how to dance.
Yeah. That was great.
I was like, finally, Rose gets to be herself.
Yeah, and they look
like. She's a nice girl.
Right. Exactly.
And they look like teenagers.
Exactly. A little bit of just, letting your hair down and having some fun and not worrying about who's going to think what about whom and who's judging whom. Yeah. Let's just be girls and have fun.
Yeah.
Yes. It's beautiful.
It's adorable.
It's a great stolen moment.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, took all 3 seconds.
I thought Susan was gonna. I just had this at the when they were having fun.
Me
I was like,
too.
Susan's gonna walk in.
My stomach. I was like, oh no, stop.
Moment
it.
Of happiness for Rose. It can't last.
Do we have any other favorite moments?
I do. I wanted to talk about this in the beginning, but then we kind of got off topic. But Matthew, when he meets his baby and says, "Hello, my dearest chap," and says, "I wonder if he knows how much joy he brings." And that he says, "I feel like I swallowed a box of fireworks."
Yeah.
Aww. So many good lines in that scene.
How sweet was that? But then he's dead.
Yeah.
Aww. Carson's excitement. Over the baby that he doesn't even ask the sex of the baby.
That was so great.
Oh, he's so good. That moment was really fun. I mean, the calm before the storm. I don't know. I love Carson. He and Mrs. Patmore and Mrs. Hughes are really three of my favorite characters. But his excitement so that he could barely, like, articulate himself, which is unusual for him.
Yeah, he's busy.
It was beautiful. I mean, I loved it.
That was good. Yeah. That was very good.
He's never out of it. All right, so we covered everything. Shall we move on to news and gossip?
I want
to
hear the news.
Okay.
We have lots of news.
I've got a lot of news.
And after news, we'll go to our special segment.
Yeah.
Oh, no, just do predictions and a special segment.
Okay.
Julian Fellows says that he does not blame Dan Stevens for leaving Downton.
Says, who does he blame?
I'm not going to criticize him. It's a very funny career to try to make any sense, as I only know too well. And when you definitely feel like something is the right move, you've got to do it. But I was very sad. And then talking about the reason why Dan Stevens left, yeah. there's been a lot of speculation about it. And there's nothing really terribly clear yeah. has come out. But there is one thing that Julian Fellows said. He says the American network NBC, which owns the production company, which makes the show, basically bankrolled the first series. And there was talk that it didn't want to put so much money in this time. Even with all this, there is still a plan to do a fifth series, Whoa. Or as we would call them, season. So we'll definitely, at least as far as it goes right now, going to have a season 4 and 5.
Wow.
Yay, we better.
Maggie Smith is on 60 Minutes tonight.
Oh. Yeah, I read what? That.
As we're doing this right now.
In a very rare sit-down interview, and she revealed in this interview that she has never seen a single episode of Downton Abbey.
What?
I love her for that.
Uh-huh. She says, I don't sit down to watch it, and the reason why is because she's yeah. simply too much of a perfectionist, and she worries that watching herself on TV would lead her to second-guess her own performance. Yes.
I get
yeah.
that.
Yeah.
I get it.
That makes sense.
Oh,
and then she said that she will look at it when it's all over.
And she's not.
Maybe.
Maybe.
Yeah.
Maybe. Yeah, so like, what's the point? Move on.
I feel kind of sad for her to not get to see Downton Abbey.
I know. It's such a good show. She's missing out.
She's missing out.
She lived it.
All right. So we have some season 4 news.
Yes.
Julian Fellows says that Mary trying to rebuild her life will be a key theme for season 4.
Okay, there we go.
She will be getting a new boyfriend.
What?
Lord Anthony Gillingham.
Okay.
Interesting.
There's been lots of speculation.
Do we know who's playing?
No, there's lots of speculation about it. But they do say that he will also be in season 5.
Okay. Hey now.
So it's going to be serious for whoever becomes Lord Anthony Gillingham.
2 seasons out of it.
Awesome.
He
awesome.
Also said about season 4 that the killing off of beloved characters is over.
Finally.
Thankfully.
Thank you.
He says, we don't want it turning into Midsummer Murders where they live in the same village and 450 people get murdered.
Okay, good to know.
So we can sort of relax with that.
Right.
Okay, good.
Anna and Bates, now that Bates is free, Joanne Froggatt, who plays Anna, said that there is some good news in store for the couple.
Oh, that
maybe.
Oh, no. I think it does. She doesn't say that, but she says, you certainly see Anna and Bates in times of happiness, which I think was well needed. She says, I'm afraid I can't say much more, but I don't think you'll be disappointed. Mm. She also says Anna's getting a look and a new hairstyle.
What? Uh-oh.
So there you go, all you fashionistas.
Wow. What?
and the other thing that she said that I thought was really interesting, she said, there are certainly aspects of Anna's character that I've never seen before, and I think these scripts are the best yet. Julian Ooh. Fellows has done such an incredible job.
Interesting.
Okay. Oh, yeah.
Right.
I believe that.
So that's wonderful.
Exciting.
Season 4 set to premiere January 2014.
What?
I
In
think
the US.
We're all going to have a heart attack before then. However, I have some great news for Americans with this.
All
I am so excited about this. Julian Fellows is set to write and produce The Gilded Age for the U.S. network NBC. A pilot is in development.
Nice.
It is a period drama following the lives of the wealthy in New York in the 19th century.
Okay.
It's billed as an epic tale of the princes of the American Renaissance and the vast fortunes that they made and spent in the late 19th century New York.
Nice.
So that's very exciting. There's talk that probably the Martha Levinson character that was played by Shirley MacLaine was part of his entree into that world.
Oh, don't excite me. Please
but
keep her.
So, The Gilded Age. I think it sounds so fabulous. I'm really looking forward
to
that.
I do too, but I'm scared now. Because NBC doesn't do too well with its shows. They always get canceled.
That worries me a little bit.
Maybe Julian Fellows will break records with NBC like he did with Masterpiece Theater and PBS.
Oh, God, I hope
Yay.
So.
If anyone can do it.
Right.
I've got a little more. Hugh Bonneville, who plays Robert Crawley, says, I don't think I have a huge amount in common with Robert, and if I met him at a dinner party, I don't know that we'd have a lot to say. He says, underneath it all, this series is about romance rather than sex. It's about tension rather than violence. And it's about family, both the literal family and the staff as a family. Mm-hmm. And that's sort of his talk about why the show works. He says, these days when we have relationships that are forged, consummated, and brought to an end in 24 hours, but back then the pace of life was slower, and I think we like to breathe and enjoy that world, and that's why we're so in love with Downton Abbey. And then just to return to some of the news that we talked about with Dan Stevens a ways back, he defended Benedict Cumberbatch.
Oh.
Who, if you'll remember, on Twitter, or not on Twitter, was quoted as saying that Downton Abbey was effing atrocious.
Yes.
Benedict.
Yes.
Dan Stevens says, from what he has told me and from what I understand, he was misquoted or certainly quoted out of context. But the thing that upset people was there's sort of an unwritten rule that whatever you think of other people's shows, you don't diss them to journalists. And so it was a misstep, really,
okay.
Sort of what Dan Stevens is saying.
Final
thing about Dan Stevens, poor Matthew. He's apparently being lined up to play Jane Austen's brooding romantic hero, Mr. Darcy. But he's the favorite to star in a BBC adaptation of Death Comes to Pemberley, a 2011 P.D. James murder story based around the characters of Darcy and Elizabeth Bennet.
Okay.
So it's kind of a modern take on that. A couple other actors up for that as well, but he looks to be in the lead. So that's
okay.
What we have
that's
for
our news.
Wow. And gossip.
He's no Colin Firth, but we'll see.
All right. We've already had some predictions. Let's move on to others.
Oh, my goodness.
All right. Well,
and now, you're after Buzz TV predictions.
So we'll recap a little bit. We think that Mary, well, obviously we know now that
Mary's getting a boyfriend.
Yeah, and we think Edith is going to be stepping out with Michael Gregson,
right?
The editor.
Yes.
But we think that obviously going to be tension with the sisters, because if Edith is happy, Mary was not going to be happy about
that. Yes. Rose is going to be in the mix, because
right.
She's going to be a bit of a sister.
She'll still be sassy. Will she be as sassy for the Downton crew as she is with
Rose?
Susan? Rose, yeah.
Well, I think she may influence Edith a little bit.
Ooh.
Which is going to be kind of interesting if that's the case.
Yeah.
I think that could make for some great drama and conflict.
Well, every woman that comes into the household, I wonder, Branson?
That's, oh my
I
God,
have that
no,
same thought. No, this is scary.
Rose and Tom.
Really?
I have to wonder. I mean,
she's
honestly.
So young, though.
I mean,
you every time, even with Edith a couple times before Gregson, I was like, no. No, I mean, I don't know why. My mind just goes there.
But she obviously likes wealthy husbands, so I'm not sure.
Who's that?
Rose.
Rose?
That's who
she
was out with. Well,
she was kind of acting out at the time, though, wasn't she? You know?
He's been married, so.
Okay.
He could fit that bill.
All right.
I don't know. I mean, it might be illicit. It might not. I mean, obviously, it's not right. I mean, it doesn't seem like they would. She's a good fit. She's not ready to be a mother. But I don't know. I'm curious to see if there's going to be some tension there.
I think Tom and James are gonna hook up.
You
gotta do? I had that thought too.
When James walked into the room, I thought something was gonna happen. I don't know why.
Well, he
I got that
is
sense.
Awfully good looking,
yes.
Which is sometimes a you know
wow.
he's very well groomed.
I mean, they both are.
They
honestly.
Talk about how handsome he is, like obnoxiously handsome.
He's shown no interest in any of the females, which
yes.
I mean it doesn't mean anything. I know,
good point.
But it's like he just I don't know. I feel like there was a bit of tension when he came in, where he seems like now that he's open to Thomas, like maybe he's kind of like a little more just open in general, even though he said he wasn't. I don't know.
I think friendship could lead to other things.
Really?
Hey.
Okay.
I
think that could make for some great TV.
Listening, Julian.
Yeah.
Give us what we want.
Is Daisy going to stay, or is she going to go work the farm?
Daisy's
good
stay.
Question.
Just because she's one of my faves.
Yeah.
Yeah. Alfred is no Daisy. I'm sorry. You can't put Alfred in the... I mean, because I was reading some things saying maybe they'll put Alfred in the role since he really wants to be cooking. But he's... I mean, he's no Daisy. Like, Daisy's interesting to me. Like, her
yes.
character arc has been very interesting.
I agree.
Alfred I have yet to feel a lot about.
Right.
You know?
I agree with that. I agree with that. Do you have any predictions, Sean?
No, you guys already took them off.
I don't think I have
no,
them either. Those are pretty good.
Yeah.
Those are pretty
good. I'm going to live with those. I'm good.
Awesome.
How about you, Marissa? Anything?
Nope.
No? Okay, good. All right, then let's move on to our
special
segment.
Talk about Katrina.
All right, Katrina.
Yes.
So, we all know you as, you know, the voice, season 2 star. And you were in the semifinals of Adam Levine's team.
I was.
Yes.
Yes, that was fun.
Yeah, I imagine it would be.
Yeah.
But now, right now, you're currently doing an album, correct?
Yeah, I'm going to start the album in a couple weeks. We just finished a Kickstarter to crowdfund it.
Nice.
On Friday, actually, and we're fully funded, so I'm finally ready to get in the studio and start recording what
I've been writing. You started your Kickstarter fund on Friday, and you're fully funded by today.
Oh, no, I wish. No, oh. We just ended it.
Oh, got it.
It ended on, like, early Saturday morning, and it was to the wire, I have to say.
Oh, yeah.
As it is with Kickstarter.
Yeah.
We were fully funded Friday evening and then some. So
that's great. Exciting. Congratulations.
Thank you so much. I'm like thrilled. Finally ready now to like do this.
It takes
and
a little
preparation,
stress
you've been
off.
Writing, right?
Yeah, I mean, honestly, a lot of people I think kind of dove back into it,
sure.
What they were doing before the show, after the show. But for me, I needed to kind of figure out my musical aesthetic and
right.
who I wanted to be going forward. And I did just months of kind of being a hermit and writing and co-writing and just trying to figure everything out. And I didn't want to do an album until, I mean, I had everything written. I didn't want to find funding until I knew what I was doing going forward. So.
And can you tell us a little bit about that process or what it was like to write with, I assume, colleagues or people that you knew? Or did
yeah,
you write with people
I mean,
you didn't
I,
know,
I did a lot of writing on my own. I wrote with some people that were actually mutual friends that mm-hmm. I didn't know that well before the show. I didn't really write with any of the contestants. That's uh-huh. the one thing that I regret, and I know there's still time for that. But yeah, I mean, it really opened me up because before the show, I'd taken 2 years off. I didn't really know who I was as an artist. And after the show, I had a kind of a lot to say. I had a lot of stuff to process through my writing. So,
oh, did you surprise yourself with some of the things you were saying?
I did. There's, you know, I think I'm a little more of a strong kind of. I have more power than I thought I did.
Oh, that's great. That's a good thing to surprise yourself.
Yeah. At least it felt like I did.
And what kind of music can we expect from you? Is it going to be something that we're used to hearing from you, or did you venture out?
I mean, I think I ventured out a little. There's definitely a couple of ballads, kind of like the things I did on mm-hmm. the show, like Jar of Hearts.
Right.
I love my ballads. I never met a sad song I didn't like, so there's plenty of that. But there's also some stronger, more aggressive songs, kind of, I call it indie pop for grown-ups.
Okay, nice.
But, I mean, like, the single that we're going to hopefully put out, like, in March or April mm-hmm. is kind of along the lines of Pink
right.
or Kelly Clarkson
wow.
with like a touch
okay.
of gold rap from like the late 90s.
That's great.
So.
Well, that's very
nice.
Exciting.
It is exciting.
You don't have released it just yet, but you'll let us know and you'll tweet it out to everybody.
Oh,
so
absolutely.
Look for that.
Definitely.
So
definitely.
Sure look for a Twitter feed, so I'm sure
yes.
she'll let everybody know.
Oh,
what
I
is
know.
Your Twitter handle so we can write it down right now?
I was
now.
Just about to get to that. Thank you very much, Tamara.
It's Katrina P. Music.
Katrina
okay.
P. Music.
And then,
yes.
and then we'd love to have you come back on. And if you pick a show and you come back on, you can
absolutely.
Announce it to everybody and do it from here as well.
Well, thank you very much. I'm going to take you up on that offer.
Yeah,
you got to come back for the voice recap.
Oh, that would be fun. I tweet cap it, actually. I mean, I'm kind of obsessed with it. Now that I'm not on the show, I'm a little bit of the rabid fan. Watching every show and, like, having my favorites and, you know.
That's good.
And let's see, you've also done, we got a show coming up at the Hotel Cafe on March 16th.
I do. I'm excited. It's a Saturday night. It's going to be me and my guys, my fellows, my full
nice.
Band. They're amazing. And a lot of the songs we're going to be doing are off the album with a few
nice.
Select covers. So, I mean, it's going to be a really good time. I love the Hotel Cafe. I think it's a great venue. It's very intimate, but there's enough space to get a lot of people in there.
Mm-hmm.
So
and where can they
good.
Find that? Do they purchase tickets or what?
Yeah, we're actually going to put the link up in the next
great.
Week or so. Everything,
okay.
everything comes through on Twitter.
Okay,
I'll announce everything
go.
On Twitter.
And you just did a stint on the Marie Show, correct?
I did. So much fun. I used to watch the Hallmark Channel all the time mm-hmm. when I lived at home, so I'm excited
nice.
About that. And I did two of the songs that are going to be on the album.
Okay.
So, and she's great. She is such a pleasure. So it was nice to meet it, kind of an icon that I'm a little in love with. So it was great.
That's fun.
Yeah. So, and what was it like recently? You got back with you were at a party, a Maroon 5 party, and you met up
yeah.
with Adam again. How'd that go?
The Grammy party, right?
Oh yeah, it was Maroon 5 Grammy party.
Yeah.
I was like, what are they doing, letting me into this? You know? But they did, and he was there, and I haven't seen him since the show. I mean, he's a busy guy, and it's
sure.
like, you know, we're in different circles, but. I approached him and he was amazing.
Oh, that's great.
I mean, he was so nice. I mean, he was always very kind and gracious,
yes.
and he always smelled good. But particularly
little
AfterBuzz that
exclusive right there.
He smells really good, and his cologne smells almost as good as he does. Because you got that in your gift bag on the way out. I've been wearing it, the men's one actually.
Ooh.
So I could say I'm wearing Adam Levine right
nice.
Now, actually. No, it was amazing. He was just as kind and gracious as ever. So it was so good to see him again. I couldn't have asked for a better kind of reunion.
Well, that's terrific.
It was good.
And that's
mm-hmm.
great to hear.
Good to hear, yeah.
It's always nice to know that someone's like Adam's there.
Yeah.
Yes.
All right. So, well, that's good. So we'll pay attention to the Twitter feed for all that information,
please.
Especially the album coming out and when how they can get tickets to, what is it, the Hotel Cafe.
March 16th.
That's coming up quickly. That's
yes, exciting. And when the Marie show will air, I'll send out a tweet.
I should know
in the next few days, so hopefully soon.
Great. Okay. Yeah. Well, yeah, I guess that anybody else have anything else you want to share about that?
No, I think we covered everything. You're so thorough. Goodness gracious.
All right. Well, then that wraps it up here for us. Let's play that music out.
Yeah.
So along with getting your Twitter feed to Katrina Parker, what is it, Katrina? Make sure I get this right,
Katrina P Music. Yeah.
As I was saying without the P. Alina, let everybody know where they can find you.
@_Alina23, that's A-L-I-N-A, 2-3. And also Thursday nights on Project Runway here at AfterBuzz.
Tamara.
I am really sad that this is our last Downton Abbey. I just want to say that on our way out. This, it's going to be a long, stinking 11 months before we see this again.
Yeah.
You can find me on Twitter @TamaraBerg, T-A-M-A-R-A-B-E-R-G. I also have a groovy website. That is TamaraCentral.com. I've got new jewelry up that I put up this week with antique English metals incorporated into the pieces. So take a look. When you go onto my website, there's a link that says jewelry. You can take a look. Brand new old pieces up there.
And on a sister show of Marie's on the Hallmark Channel.
Yes, I'm also on the Hallmark Channel on Home and Family. I'll be on this Wednesday.
Awesome.
You should come on Home and Family. I'll talk to some people, see if we can get you on.
Please do.
That would be good.
Okay, Marissa, they're going to find you where?
I do Glee and Once Upon a Time tonight on Sundays, and I'll be engineering every other show here.
There you go. All right. Then you can find me on Justified. That's it. All right. And on behalf of everybody here, we want to thank you for tuning in, especially this short season. We wish it was longer. We wish we'd be with you every week. But, hey, that's the way it goes with British period pieces.
Darn them.
That's what they do.
They hook us, and then they leave us hanging.
That's right.
Oh, it's a killer.
More. All right. Well, thank you very much, everybody, and we will talk to you
next
in a
time.
Year.
Oh, my goodness.
From Bing.com, executive producers Maria Menounos, Kevin Undergaro, Phil Svitek, and the entire AfterBuzz TV staff, we would like to thank you for listening to the AfterBuzz TV Network. To watch or listen to other after shows and post comments or questions, be sure to visit AfterBuzzTV.com. I'm Sir Richard Wentworth, and this has been a presentation of AfterBuzz TV.
Buzz you later. Cup of tea.
Views expressed herein are those of the hosts only and do not necessarily reflect the views of AfterBuzz TV or its owners or principals.